I invite you to stand and turn and face the cross. Let us now be led in a time of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us come before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others and your creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Let us pray. Lord of the feast, you have prepared a table before all peoples and poured out your life with abundance. Call us again to your banquet. Strengthen us by what is honorable, just, and pure, and transform us into a people of righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning and welcome to the worship of God on this Consecration Sunday. How many of you enjoyed breakfast downstairs before you came to worship? Let me see your hands. Okay, I've got my eyes on you. That is not a license to nap later in the service. But if you do, Danielle will speak louder and wake you up. We do welcome her with us this morning, and her biography is written in our worship folder. You will hear more about the process of how we will offer our pledges to God later in the service, But I am so glad to see those of you who are worshiping here with us, those who have joined us online. Thank you for your presence among us. A couple of things that are happening before we gather together again, and that is this Wednesday night, rather than a discipleship class following our Wednesday night meal, there will be a prayer service in our chapel at 6:15. All of you are welcome to come as we gather together in that space for a time of prayer and reflection. So I hope that I will see you there. And then, actually, we will be here next Sunday, but next Sunday night at 7 o'clock, Tom Kiesecker will be here in concert. Many of you are acquainted with him. I am looking forward to meeting him, to hearing his music, and please make a place in your schedule for that as well. Whether you are our guest or whether you are a regular attender or a member, there are connection cards in the back of the pew in front of you. We are trying to update our data in our database. If there's anything that has changed, or if you would like to make sure that the information is accurate in our system, I encourage you to complete that connection card, put it in the offering plate, and we will take care of that information as well. I think that is it for the announcements this morning. I invite you to pause for a few moments as we prepare our hearts for the reading of God's Word through the music of Kevin and Janie. Thank you.
A reading from the book of Philippians. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
As we begin our gospel reading today, I'm going to invite you to put your paper down because I'm preaching on something else. So you can't follow along, but I invite you to simply hear the scripture, the story of Jesus. We're just going to roll with it. Okay, from Matthew 14. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowd heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave it to the disciples. And the disciples gave it to the crowds. And all ate and all were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. The gospel of the Lord. I invite you to be seated. It is good to be back with you. It is good to be in the house of God with you this day. I know some of you in this space, but I'm delighted that there are new faces here. I'm Pastor Danielle Denise, and I began serving as an associate pastor here at St. John's 11 years ago. Now, some of you feel old right now that it was 11 years ago, right? But I've got more gray hair now, and I've got an expanded family, and it is just good to be and God's house with you. I was also going to start my sermon by saying this, but you may have already picked up on it, that when Pastor Greg asked me if I would preach for Consecration Sunday, he said to me, here's a whole list of scriptures about stewardship that you could preach on. And in true Danielle fashion, I didn't pick one of those. I picked something entirely different, and I hope you know this story. And if you don't and you're new to the scriptures, I hope it is a story that worms its way into your hearts and one that invites you into considering generosity through a new lens. And so together today, I invite you to make space for our shared life together and for the way God is calling us to use and share our resources for the sake of the gospel. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts gathered in this place be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, our rock, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. So my family consigns. We take things that have been in our house and we share those with others through consignment sales. And it's a practice we adopted about 3 years ago when Michael and I, during the pandemic, looked around and thought, how did we accumulate this much stuff? I mean, there were baby clothes that our kids got to wear one time, and there was also shoes that I bought, and then magically in a weekend, our kids' feet grew to the next size. And you were like, are you kidding me? I just bought these shoes. And so we decided, let's start a practice of sharing those things we have in our space with others. Now, when I say we, I use that term very loosely, because when we started doing this, most of the Denise family was on board, except for Olive. Olive is my 5-year-old free spirit. Moses is my 6-year-old that is much more a type A personality, and you said to Moses, here's your box. He would go into his room and he'd say, I think I'm done playing with this. Let me place it in the box. And before you could almost hear the thud, Olive's hand was reaching in the box, saying, I need it, I need it. I would joke, Olive, that's not even yours to begin with, but I need it. And then you would turn your head, and pretty soon everything Moses had discarded, Olive had shoved into a nook and a cranny in her own room. 3 years later, we just consigned a whole bunch of stuff a couple weeks ago, and Olive came up to me and said, I just love consigning, Mom, because new families get to use our stuff. And I had to pause and think for a moment about how far our little Olive bug had come in 3 years, moving from a mindset of scarcity, thinking, I have to have all of this, to abundance. But it didn't happen overnight, right? She was transformed by practicing holding resources loosely and letting them take new life. As I wrestled with this morning's gospel text, I was struck by Jesus teaching his disciples similar lessons. Lessons like abundance over scarcity, holding things loosely, and believing in the miracle of a new thing. Picture the scene with me. Jesus has withdrawn on a boat. He's grieving the loss of his cousin, John, who has been brutally killed. I imagine in this moment that Jesus is just trying to catch his breath, looking for maybe a place to weep or cry, a place to simply let his body rest and the grief wash over him. But the people, they've heard that Jesus is on the move, and in a boat, no less. But they are undeterred because they start to follow They follow on foot. They wait at the water's edge. And when he lands, Jesus has compassion on them and heals them. And then there is this miracle feeding. Now, before I get too far talking about miracles, I want you to notice this. The miracle feeding. The miracle feeding happens in the midst of hard realities. Jesus has every reason in the world to tap out. His grief was real and it was gutting. Jesus is completely justified in taking things into his own hands and going home. And I want you to notice this because I know whenever a group of humans gather, especially a group this size, there are some of you who are living the reality of hard things. You're tapped out. The idea about a sermon on generosity feels hollow or shallow. Life is hard and you just want to keep it all to yourself. And yet here is Jesus showing up, and in community, no less. Beloved, you are here for a reason today. In the midst of every justifiable reason to tap out, you showed up today in this community, and I believe that God will meet you with your own miracle. In the midst of that hard reality, there comes an all too human part. Now, this is my favorite part of the text because you can't read it and think, that's not me. It is each one of us. And don't try to tell me you wouldn't do the same thing. Looking at the crowds and saying, Jesus, it's late. Send these people home. They need to go eat. It's almost like the disciples are like, do you know what time it is, Jesus? Because we got some hangry people hanging out on this hill. Can you please get them out of here? And Jesus has the nerve to say, they don't need to go. You give them something to eat. And the disciples looked around. 5 loaves, 2 fish. Yeah, bro, we can't do that. The scarcity mindset takes over. They keep saying, we only have. You see, beloved, the disciples and you and I are in good company because we are so conditioned to only see, well, the only. What we don't have, it's ingrained in us. And it makes sense because if we focus on the only, then we gotta keep buying more stuff, right? To try to make it enough. We gotta keep trying to make our lives better by accumulating more. We keep trying to make the only enough on our own. And Jesus knows this propensity to scarcity. And so he says to the disciples, bring those fish and loaves to me. Now I want you to notice two things that happen next. The first is this. Jesus infuses the only, these fish and loaves, with gratitude. And beloved, when we're stuck in a mindset of the only, gratitude is a scarce companion. It's something we're being invited to practice every time we gather and worship, and we're being invited to practice in our own lives of faith. In the month of November, my family gets one of our pumpkins that's been sitting out on the porch in October that hopefully hasn't rotted by this point. And we start a gratitude pumpkin where every night we write something we're grateful for. At the 9:27 service, Taylor showed a picture of a pumpkin completely full. Ours is usually like 4 lines. So don't think we're overachievers in our households. But that practice of our gratitude pumpkin, literally in front of our very eyes, transforms us from a family that can only see the little to a family with eyes to see that there is more than enough. And in addition to this moment of gratitude that is infused into this fish and into these loaves, there's another thing. And this is ultimately why I picked this text for our sermon today. And it's this. Jesus gives the disciples back the bread and the fish to participate in the miracle. Did you catch that? He gives it back to the disciples to participate in this miracle feeding. I mean, the people were already orderly sitting down in circles in the grass. Jesus could have just said, hey, long catch, let me throw you this piece of bread. Jesus could have taken all of the credit, and yet he invites the disciples to partner in the miracle. The well-fed disciples participate in watching the hungry be satisfied. And I wondered this week if Jesus wanted the disciples to literally feel the plenty with their hands, to feel in their bodies the transformation from only these fish and loaves to more than enough. That through participating, their hearts would be transformed so that the next time that they saw two lousy fish, they wouldn't say, oh, that's only it, but instead would say, I wonder what God will do with that. A seminary professor of mine used to joke, you know how all those people on the hill actually got fed, right? It was all the mamas who looked inside their purses and said, I got a half-eaten granola bar and some crunched-up goldfish. What do you all have? How can you moms know? You're like, I got those things in my purse still. But you see, however it happened, everyone participated in the miracle. And beloved, this is the kind of work that God is calling you into today, to join your two fish with my two fish and their two fish, training our eyes to see enough and together participating in feeding our community with spiritual nourishment offered at God's table and with actual bread. Beloved, look at what God creates through this gathering of people. Together, our resources infused with gratitude and offered the community is a straight-up miracle. And it's the kind of a miracle I'm inviting you into today. Because in just a little bit, you're going to take that pledge card, which might seem as lousy as two fish and five loaves. But when it's placed in that basket and infused with gratitude and the possibility of God, miracles can and will happen. Who knows? Maybe that pledge card, your two fish, becomes actual goldfish, served as a snack in Sunday school as the youngest among us learn the stories of faith and are reminded that they are loved. Maybe your pledge cards, like five loaves, becomes a mission trip where our young people learn and walk alongside Palestinian young people who right now we're sitting in solidarity with when their world is falling apart. Who could have imagined last year when you put your pledge card in that basket that you would have made a way for this community to be in solidarity with those in Palestine? In the midst of the atrocities there. Or maybe your pledge card, your two fish, will become a meal for the grieving or a community group in the midst of an epidemic of loneliness going on in our world. Beloved, I don't know where you are today. You may have come in and thought, I'm Olive. I am holding on with all I got. I need it. Or maybe you just filled out the card because, well, you were supposed to. Perhaps this day God is inviting you to believe in the miracle of possibility. We started a practice in our family when I was first here at St. John's. Well, a couple years in, I didn't have a family when I first got here. Where whenever we would bring $1 or $5 to the offering plate, on the way to church, we would ask, and still do, ask Olive and Moses, what do you think God's gonna do with that money? 5 and 6-year-olds have really fun answers. But I love it because they're practicing. They're practicing believing in the miracle of God in our midst. And beloved, I'm part of that miracle. 11 years ago, you welcomed me into this place. I had not turned 30 yet. And you made space for my voice and my whole self. Your 2 loaves and your fish have led me to a place where I was sitting on the front pew with my kid at 9:27 thinking, you're teaching her the melodies of faith that I learned from you a decade ago. That's a miracle. So I'm not surprised Jesus hands back the bread and the fish, and Jesus hands you a pledge card. Because God wants us to participate in the abundance of grace. And as you lay that pledge card in the basket, as you come forward during communion, I wonder what God will do with your 2 loaves. 2 loaves, I'm bad at math. With your 5 loaves and 2 fish. And I, for one, can't wait to witness that miracle. Amen.
And now, gathered as God's people across time and space, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, for the world, and for all in need. For the Church of Jesus Christ in this and every land, that all the followers of Christ share the mind of Christ and strive to live together in peace, staying firm in the Lord. We pray especially for the churches of Palestine and Israel, that they may be strengthened and encouraged in this time of trial, and that they may serve as witnesses to the grace and peace of Jesus Christ in the midst of conflict. God of grace, hear our prayer. For green pastures and still waters, and all the beauty of the natural world, that creation flourishes, and humankind lives in right relationships with all you have made. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations of the world, and all who hold positions of authority, that they govern in accordance with God's vision of justice, providing shelter and refuge to all in need, striving towards the goal of peace and prosperity, we pray again especially for the people of Israel and Palestine, that their leaders may put aside violence and work towards peace. We lift up those who have lost loved ones and those who are suffering deep hurt and want on both sides of this conflict. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all experiencing valleys of illness and grief and loneliness, that they may be healed and comforted and accompanied and find rest in the presence of the Good Shepherd who walks beside them. We lift before you now those we name to you silently or aloud. Jim, Tom. God of grace, hear our prayer. For this community of believers, that wherever there is conflict or discord, the love of Christ may keep us united and may make us mindful of all that is true, honorable, just, pure, pleasing, commendable, and excellent. God of grace, hear our prayer. In thanksgiving for the beloved saints who now rest in your mercy, especially Nancy Dunham, we pray that their faithful witness guides your church until the day we join them at your heavenly feast. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and in your amazing grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you all. I invite you to share signs of peace. Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now may the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, you alone are holy, you alone are God. The universe declares your praise. Beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath, we praise you, O God. Generations bless your faithfulness. Through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future, we bless you, O God. We give you thanks for your dear Son, at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now, we thank you, O God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, our Lord took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to all for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his great love for us on the way and at the table and to the end, we join our voices and proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks be to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit, in your church, without end. Amen. And now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord has taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please stand as you're able. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Christ Jesus, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us pray our prayer of consecration. Gracious and loving God, accept our pledges and grateful thanksgiving to you for your abundant grace in our lives and the redemption we have through Christ Jesus. Give us faith to recognize your work in our lives. Give us joy in serving you and lead us in the building up of faith in more people. We dedicate these pledges for your mission through St. John's during the year 2024. O God, and we dedicate them to your glory alone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. God is at work in you. Thanks be to God.